بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن شاء الله النهاردة هنستأنف بداية المحاضرات إن شاء الله، وهنبتدي بأول موضوع من الموضوعات المهمة وكلنا بنشوفه كتير، اللي هو الأستيوما. الأستيوما كان زمان فيها ديبيت كبير، لكن دلوقتي بعد الأدفانس اللي حصلت في الراديولوجيكال إيفالويشن والمانجمنت الدنيا بقت سهلة وهنتكلم فيها بالتفصيل. طبعا الأستيوما كلنا عارفين انها بناين ليجن كوزنج سيفير بين وي ارايزنج فروم ذا بون، وبتبقى عباره عن سمول ليس ذان 2 سنتيمتر دايمتر اريا اوف نورمال اوستويد اند اوستيو بلاست سراوندد باي ان اريا اوفر اكتيف بون، والاريا دي بنسميها النيدس، وبتبقى عباره عن بيور ليتيك ليجن سراوندد باي رياكتيف اسكليروزس. النيدس دي بتبقى هي السورس اوف ذا بين، لانها بتسكريت كاتاليتيك انزيم وبتبقى ريتش ان بروستاجلاندين اي 2 وانترليوكن، عشان كده بتبقى هايلي سنسيتيف للنون سترويدال، وبالتحديد اتعمل لها اول بروتوتايب طبعا للنون سترويدال كان السلسليت اللي هو بنسميه السلسليت سبريشن تيست. ودي بيتكون الثيرد موست كومن بناين بون تيومر، وبتبقى بعد الاوستيوكوندروما ونقص فرانك فايبروما، ودي بتكون تقريبا حوالي 11% اوف بناين بون تيومرز. والبيشن وذ اوستيوما زي ما قلنا بريزنتد وذ هيستوري اوف دال ايكينج بين ان ذا لونج بون ذات هاز لاستد سيفرال مانثس. ذا بين از وورس ات نايت، يعني نتيجه الكونجيشن والهايبر باراسمبثيك اكتيفيتي، فبيبقى ده بيعمل السيفير بين. وبتبقى البين ريليفد زي ما قلنا دراماتيكالي باي سلسليت او اني نون سترويدال انتي انفلاماتوري دراجز، اللي هو بالتحديد ان ايه الانتي بروستاجلاندين زي ما قلنا انها بتبقى ريتش ان بروستاجلاندين اي 2 والانترليوكين 6، ودول البين ميديتور اللي بيبقوا موجودين فيها، عشان كده بتبقى ريليف باي نون سترويدال انتي بروستاجلاندين. البيشن يوجوالي ار بتوين ذا ايجز اوف 5 اند 20 ييرز، 70% اوف بيشن ار يانجر ذان 20 ييرز، بات اونلي اباوت 3% اوف بيشن ار يانجر ذان 5 ييرز اوف ايج، اند از ليس هاز بين ريبورتد فروم ذا ايجز بتوين 8 مانثس تو 72 ييرز. الملخص المفيد انها دايما بتحصل في الادوليسنس، وبالتحديد في السن اللي هو من 5 to 20 years، ولكن any age not immune can reported at any age even in very young neonates. الحاجة الثانية انها بتبقى دايما في الديافيسز والميتافيسز of long bone، و 80% of lesions are located in long bones most frequently in the femur, tibia and the humerus, والليجن are mostly diaphyseal most common more than 70 to 80% are diaphyseal or metadiaphyseal. Osteomas may occur in close proximity to articular surface. When they occur within the synovial reflection, they are termed intra-articular osteoma. Occurring most frequently about the hip region with involvement of the femoral neck and the intertrochanteric region and the neck of the talus, followed by the intra-articular type. The location most commonly described next to long bones for osteoma are the spine and the bone of the foot and hand. The lumbar region is the most commonly affected within the spine, especially in the periapodicular region of the posterior arch is the most common affected site, either in the lamina or in the pedicle or in the junction between them. Painful scoliosis and spinal stiffness caused by osteoid osteomas are presented with the curvature concave towards the side of the region and attributed to the spasm of the paravertebral muscles. A clue to the diagnosis of osteoid osteoma induced scoliosis is the increased severity of the scoliosis in the supine position versus the erect position, opposite to that commonly seen with idiopathic scoliosis. And the scoliosis usually resolves after surgical removal of the nidus. In the foot and the talus, especially the talar neck is affected most frequently with involvement of the calcaneus after the talus is the most common site in the foot. Children with osteoma are presented with pain, which is worse at night, as we mentioned, and may awaken the patient from sleep and typically relieved by salicylate. Other frequent presenting features are limping without pain and site-specific tenderness. That's what we call fingertip pointing tenderness. The patient can localize the site of the pain by fingertip, and usually it is the site of the nidus, and followed by erythema and swelling. There is marked muscle atrophy occur with time due to disuse and pain, resulting in quadriceps inhibition, leading to marked atrophy, especially in the thigh. Lesion near apophysis may present with a limb length discrepancy due to gross acceleration and the varus or valgus deformity if it is eccentric to one side. And this is a clinical picture from the literature in the 80s. It's showing marked atrophy on the right side. And here one of our patients show the quadriceps, the vastus medialis and the rectus. Here marked atrophy of the whole heads of the quadriceps due to the severe pain of the osteoid osteoma and long-standing condition. Radiological feature depends on the location of the lesion within the bone. It is divided into four subtypes. The most common, as we mentioned, 80% is the intracortical osteoid osteoma. This is the most common type and appear on conventional radiograph as a small round to elliptical radiolucent area within the cortex, termites, the nidus, as we mentioned, and these are really exceeds 1 centimeter in diameter. It is usually one to one and a half, very rare to exceed 2 centimeter. If it is exceed 3 centimeter, it is not an osteoid osteoma. It is either lytic lesions for differential diagnosis, and mostly it may be osteoblastoma. Intracortical osteoid osteoma are surrounded by a dense region of reactive sclerotic bone, which may be very dense, that may extend for several centimeters from the central nidus. The second type of osteoid osteoma is the intramedullary osteoid osteoma. Usually are less common lesion, and they have little or no surrounding reactive bone formation, as it is usually away from the periosteum, which is responsible for the reactive bone. Intra-articular osteoid osteoma are very rare lesion and very rarely to provoke the active bone formation because it is overlapping the area of articular cartilage or where the periosteum is absent. So there is no lesion reactive bone formation, especially in the neck of the talus or when it is present in the neck of the femur. Usually there is no periosteum, so there is no reactive bone formation, but instead cause a periarticular osteopenia and sometimes reactive synovitis. The fourth type is what we call the subperiosteal osteoid osteoma. Usually have reactive bone of an intermediate quantity between intra-articular and intramedullary lesions. And usually it is presented subperiosteal. And here a classic the graphs showing the location. This is the first type, which is called the subperiosteal and the cortical, inducing huge amount of periosteal dome shape elevation of the cortex, unifocal usually. And here the endosteal type, and here the medullary type. And here a classic classification in the 80s, what's called the Kaiser classification, showing the location of the osteoma in the tubular bone. This is the normal bone, this is the subperiosteal type, and followed by the cortical location, and usually may be mixed between endosteal location, and the lastly is the medullary type. And here another graphic showing the descriptive term is nicely showing here the intramedullary and the periosteal. It is nearly the same, but the location within the bone, and usually both of them leads to severe active bone sclerosis with dome shape unifocal elevation of the cortex. And this is the endosteal type, and this is the medullary central type with less evident cortic periosteal new bone formation or cortical dome shape elevation. The intra-articular intracortical osteoid osteoma, most commonly typed as we mentioned, small lytic area around to elliptical within the cortex, and usually the nidus doesn't exceed 1 centimeter, and surrounded by a dense region of reactive bone may extend to several centimeters from the central nidus. And here an example in the femur showing dome shape elevation and marked sclerosis in comparison to the proximal or distal or the contralateral side of the bone, and the small nidus is here apparent. and here in the fibula with the midas and the severe active sclerosis, and also in the tibia with dome shape elevation, and here in the radius showing the classic elevation with dense sclerosis and the small midas inside, and here in the humerus showing a small lytic lesion in the AB, and after making the lateral view showing the classic midas in the subosteal cortical location. And here another example in the distal third of the fibula with severe dense sclerosis. The intramedullary pseudo osteoma are less common lesions, and they have little or no surrounding reactive bone formation due to it is away from the periosteum. And here at the example of a medullary pseudo osteoma in the metaphysis of the proximal tibia, and here in the MRI and the CT showing the nidus, small lytic lesion surrounded by edema and the sclerosis. And here another small lytic lesion in the distal femur, eccentric to one side, and here the MRI and the CT showing the peritium lesional edema, absent sclerosis, and the classic nidus. The intra-articular osteoma are very rare lesion and is very rarely to provoke reactive bone formation, as we mentioned early, because of the absence of the periosteal sleeve around the neck of the femur or the neck of the teres, because of both of them are surrounded by intracapsular and with absent periosteum, and instead cause a periarticular osteoporosis, as we mentioned, and reactive synovitis. And here, multiple different example in the neck of the femur. You know, here as the calcar area, here in the middle of the neck, here, superior neck, and here just subphyseal. And another example showing different location for, and another example of periarticular showing in the distal radius, nearly in the subchondral area near the stylobrosis of the radius with the classic nidus in the CT scan. Subperiosteal osteoma usually is presented at the metadiaphyseal area with elevation, dome shape elevation of the periosteum in location, and have intermediate quality between quantity of a reactive bone formation between the intracortical and the intramedullary lesions. Radiological features. Usually, osteoma can be confirmed most commonly by a standard radiograph, what we call the X-ray. The diagnosis of osteoma often requires the use of other radiological studies for several reasons, because long-standing lesions usually evoked aggressive periosteal reaction, leading to obscure of the nidus. Becomes not apparent, especially in complex anatomical sites like the spine and in the pelvic, or in if neglected for a large long time. The typical radiographic finding may not become evident on brain X-ray until several months after the patient first presents clinical symptoms, the reactive bone formation, or even normal anatomical bone, as we mentioned in the spine, may obscure the location of the nidus. Some lesions are a typical location present without the easily identifiable a reactive sclerosis. And here, multiple examples showing long-standing history of diffuse pain, and here unifocal diffuse periosteal reaction with marked dense sclerotic bone in the femur, as we see in different location with dome shape unifocal, and the nidus cannot be localized from the X-ray. It may be stress fracture, reactive bone, callus formation, extensive callus. So further evaluation by CT, MRI, and bone scan is required. And also another example in the tibia showing the dome shape sclerotic bone, and here in the this lesion is maybe as the peripheral nidus here surrounded by the dense sclerosis. Also in the finger and the toes, it may be surrounded by reactive sclerosis resulting in deformity and the stiffness, as we see clinically here, marked swelling and X-ray showing the small nidus here and here and here, in another example in the middle finger, in the index, in the ring, and in a different location with the dense reactive sclerotic bone. Also in the spine, as we mentioned, it usually results in the periapical area with painful scoliosis, as here another different example, multiple types, and Radiological features include from the X-ray, differential diagnosis of stress fracture with reactive callus formation, osteomyelitis, especially chronic type and or bone abscess when it has become organized and the subperosteal calcified hematoma or pus, bone island, especially if it is eccentric to one side, especially if it is small, less than 1 centimeter. So CT scan is mandatory and for differentiating different lesions and for better evaluation and localization of zonitis. Usually CT scan shows a well-circumscribed small area of low attenuation lytic lesion representing zonitis. As we mentioned, surrounded by a larger area of higher attenuation representing the reactive bone formation. The slices of 1 to 2 millimeter may be required to demonstrate the lesion. The standard CT scan usually done at 5 or 10 millimeter cuts. You know, the lesion is 1 centimeter. If we only one cut can demonstrate the lesion. So to accurately localize the lesion, that you must prescribe in your request a slices of 1 to 2 millimeter cuts because the lesion is too small. It is only 1 centimeter. Thin slices leads to a demonstration of the lesion over 5 or 6 cuts, which will demonstrate zonitis accurately. CT scan are especially helpful for the localization of lesions that are arise in the spine. Because the standard of graph, zonitis is often obscured with overlapping shadow of normal spinal anatomy. And here, multiple different examples after making the CT. Here on the right, a stablem, resistant pain with dome-shaped sclerotic lesion in comparison with the contralateral left side. And after making the CT, the midas is well evident in the posterior wall of the stablem. And another example with pain localized at the level of the lesser trochanter when the midas is evident here. And another lesion with dense sclerosis with absent midas in the X-ray and after making the CT, here is a vacant area that's called the midas surrounded by dense sclerotic bone, which is very well evident. Another example in the neck femur, another example in the proximal humerus, we just a sub-surgical neck of the humerus and here showing the midas surrounded by sclerosis and confirmed by the CT scan, dense sclerotic area in the midas inside. Sometimes the 3D formula of the CT will demonstrate the lesion accurately in such a case, a dome shape elevation with absent midas. And here a small midas, and here can be measured, it is less 1 millimeter, less than 1 centimeter as we show here. In the coronal and sagittal cuts of the CT scan with accurate localization of zonitis. And here, patient with extensive recurrent pseudosteoma with marked dense sclerosis for about more than 10 centimeter. Zonitis is cannot be localized easily after making the CT. And here in the coronal cuts, the midas is well evident. And here in the sagittal cut, and here with dense sclerosis with a reactive bone, it's very extensive in the axial cut. Also here, dense sclerosis, and here demonstration of zonitis is very clear. Another example in the tibia was marked sclerosis with accurate localization of zonitis in the two examples. And here in the distal tibia posterior with reactive dense sclerosis, and here zonitis is well evident. Also in this patient, dense sclerotic area with the midas here in the CT is well evident purely intracortical lesions. And here in the humerus with reactive dense sclerosis with small tiny lesion, it is well demonstrated in the CT scan. And another example we show early, and here the midas is evident purely cortical lesions. In the spine with reactive sclerosis, the X-ray, showing nothing, just mild curve. It may be spasm disc or what is the different differential diagnosis. And after making the CT and the level of periapicular area in L4 showing the midas here in the pedicle area is well evident and demonstrated. And also this patient had persistent sacroiliac pain for 2 years without reaching diagnosis, and was injected steroid twice by one of our colleagues of spinal surgery, and diagnosed as sacroiliitis. And after making the CT, the midas is very evident here, as we see in the ala of the sacrum. And also in the distal fibula, there is dense sclerosis, maybe infection, osteomyelitis, and after making the CT, the midas is very evident in the axial and the coronal cuts. Also in the calcaneus, dense sclerotic area here, and after making the CT, the midas is evident inside the calcaneus. And here another example with severe sclerosis. The third investigation is the isotope bone scan. Precise localization of the midas is important for the surgical management of patients, especially in patients with negative radiograph finding in whom the diagnosis of osteoma is suspected. Therefore, for accurate localization, a sensitive method to help localization of the lesion, the bone scan will show a markedly increased level of uptake in affected area on both the initial blood pool and the delayed phase images. And here, female patient presented bilateral mid-leg pain, more severe on the right side. And a small lesion, query, it may be stress fracture, it may be, and also in the left side, the same, a reactive bone in the mid-tibia. And the CT showing a medullary small query lesions, as we see, with the reactive sclerosis after making the bone scan. There is activity bilateral in the mid-tibia, more with the localized with the nidus of the right side, demonstrating the lesion of the osteoma. And here, another case of dome shape elevation with periosteal reaction and a small suspicious nidus after making the CT, showing the lesion with the classic finding of a low attenuation area in a higher attenuation, dense sclerotic bone showing the central nidus purely cortical. And after making the bone scan, as we see, it is classic metaphyseal hyperactive area in both blood pool and delayed image stage with the reactive sclerosis around the nidus. Also, this patient presented with severe agonizing pain in the right shoulder with finger pointing tenderness localized to the glenoid, as we see. Here, the X-ray is showing nothing, dense sclerotic area, and the nidus cannot be localized. And here, after making the CT, the nidus is evident in the inferior bowl of the glenoid. And after making the bone scan, a sharp localization of the location of the nidus is well evident. Radiographic features after that is less evident by making the MRI, because the MRI appears as a dense sclerotic area like the cortex with medullary edema. So it is not 100% conclusive. CT is better for evaluation and leads to a sharper contrast between the nidus and the active bone. But sometimes MRI has been done. And as we see here, dense sclerotic area, reactive bone and edema, and nothing else. Sometimes with higher quality MRI in the periapicular area, in the lower bowl of the patella, as we see, and here in the neck of the femur, diffuse synovitis, effusion, and the nidus here is localized. And here in the tibia, under the tuberosity, also the nidus with peritumoral edema and the hemorrhage, as we see, the reactive bone and the sclerosis. And here, a case of osteoma in the scaphoid. And this is the scaphoid bone with the nidus here, and will demonstrate it with the lesional edema in the MRI. Also, in the lateral condyle of the distal humerus, with a suspicious lesion here, as we see in the capitellum, with osteolytic dense, with litama here, it is an intraarticular, so there is no reactive bone, there is no sclerosis, marked sclerosis, just a lytic small lesion. And here in the CT, the nidus is evident in the capitellum here, very well demarcated, and the MRI showing dense sclerotic bone, mild, with reactive severe synovitis and effusion, simulating pigmental villonodular synovitis, but the other medullarity of investigation CT and X-ray showing it is a reactive synovitis, not a true pigmented villonodular synovitis due to the presence of the small nidus as we see under the arrow here. And this is the lesion. Also, in young children, MRI sometimes demonstrates the reactive synovitis. It is here secondary to the osteoma in the metaphyseal area with the nidus is evident in the CT and the X-ray and MRI with severe active sclerosis and excluding it is a peripheral reaction of osteosarcoma as we see. It is just reactive sclerosis with peritumoral edema and the nidus is evident in all the investigation. Also, epiphyseal osteoma, it is very, very, very rare and sometimes presented in young children with severe synovitis and irritation of the knee. As we see here, with the nidus is evident in the X-ray, CT, and the MRI with peritumoral or perilesional edema in the metaphyseal area, as we see. In the calcaneus, with dense sclerotic area here, showing the nidus in the CT and the MRI with the perilesional edema. Here in another osteoma in the calcaneus, in the calcaneal tuberosity with increased activity in the bone scan and peritumoral edema in the MRI. Also here in the neck of the talus, showing the sclerotic area and MRI showing the reactive synovitis and the very lesional edema around the nidus. طبعاً the list in required investigation. This one case presented for me by referred from one of our colleague showing a PET scan with the activity of the nidus. It is not mandatory and it is expensive and not required for diagnosis of osteosarcoma. But it's just I present because this patient come to me from one of our colleague and showing here the lesion in the L5. Left side peripedicular area with the increased activity, very minimal and localized and the classic, but it is too much to pay 1,000 pound for a PET scan for diagnosis of osteosarcoma. Just I show the case because it presented for me. Osteoma has a very characteristic gross appearance after resection. Usually it is in a small or round around the small area, as we mentioned, not more than 1 centimeter, like cherry, right? Cherry red or reddish brown lesion, usually showing the very huge reddish area. And here is a lesion on the fibula after resection showing the nidus with red cherry area. In diameter, great sensation depending on the vascularity, sometimes showing a different degree of calcification according to the maturity of the lesion. Older lesion usually have more calcified peripheral rim with less vascular area and have a yellow white color. Osteoma appears as a small, well defined area of interlacing irregular trabecular osteoid mineralized matrix. We have a rimming surrounding the bone of hypervascular area, dilated capillaries responsible for the vascularity of the lesion. Under electron microscopes, the vein associated with osteoma is caused by a numerous non-myelinated axons within the nidus. This is one other cause of source of vein. So at night, congestion occur due to the, as we mentioned early, due to hyperparasympathetic activity at night, leading to congestion resulting in irritation of the myelinated axon, non-myelinated axon within the nidus leading to increased severity of the pain, plus it is rich in prostaglandin, as we mentioned. The lesion is commonly demarcated from the normal host bone by 1 to 2 millimeter area of fibrovascular, and usually intra-articular lesions commonly associated with chronic synovitis. And the last point in the lecture is method of treatment. Usually, osteoma is a self-limited disease with a spontaneous healing and ossification, but takes about 2 to 5 years. Most of the literature talks about 2 to 5 years, but some articles mention that it may last for 7 years to reach to the full maturation and spontaneous healing. Yeah, but the usual is 2 to 5 years. A complication of persistent pain and untreated osteoma all of them are mentioned in the early. The most important is the accelerated bone growth if the nidus located near the growth plate, as we mentioned, resulting on accelerated growth or varus or vargas according to its location is eccentric. Painful scoliosis if nidus located near the neural arch and usually resolve with treatment. Early arthritis of the nidus located interarticular within the joint capsule, and the most risky is the recurrence if the nidus is not completely excised or retreated. Medical treatment has a long history, and usually the use of long-term use of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs for patients whom surgical removal may be complicated or cause disability or patient refusing surgery. Medical treatment has been successful in several cases, but the patient must know it's long lasting for up to 5 years at minimum, with precaution must be taken, especially in skeletal immature patient with the risk of skeletal abnormality and limb length discrepancy besides the GIT and the kidney troubles for the long use of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. And here, example of osteoma in the neck of the femur with a spontaneous regression and ossification and the full maturation and pain disappearance after 2 years follow-up. Another example of osteoma in the distal tibia and the follow-up for more than 5 years with spontaneous regression to and the remodeling of the bone with complete disappearance of the nidus. The standard treatment for osteoma is the complete removal of the nidus, surgically extremely effective, bringing immediate and complete relief. Symptoms recur if the part of the nidus remains postoperatively, either after surgery or after radiofrequency, as we will show after that. The sclerotic reactive bone usually spontaneously resolve and the remodeling occur and may not need to be removed. In fact, leaving reactive bone in place is important to decrease the risk of postoperative fracture. It is very important to localize the nidus intraoperative. The difficulty in the treatment of osteoma comes from intraoperative localization. And to reach the localization, either in the conventional radiograph by a marker technique and resective specimen, and the use of image intensifier with the marker technique until localization under image. And this is the next lecture next week, inshallah. Bone scintigraphy, if it's available in the intraoperative, or CT guidance, if it is available also intraoperative, and tetracycline label, nidus have affinity for tetracycline, and this drug has inherent ability to fluorescence under ultraviolet lights. Nidus must be removed completely and to ascertain that it has can be removed in block with a margin of reactive bone around the lesion. If the bone element critical for stability or are removed in weight-bearing bone, especially in the femur and the tibia, bone graft and or internal fixation may be necessary. And this is the third lecture, inshallah. Summarized, the line of treatment of osteoma, either conservative, medical, surgical, non-steroidal, but with the hazard of non-steroidal and gross, especially in children, kidney and GIT, and limb length discrepancy. The second line is many invasive technique, and it is a recent technique being explored in many centers, what is called radio frequency ablation. In Arabic, it's called التردد الحراري or الكي الحراري of the lesion, and it must be done under CT guidance by our colleague on the interventional radiography units. And in CHAMS, we have a full equipped team, but it is not easy. It needs a very well trained personnel and a highly specialized person to localize. And in my team, in CHAMS, alhamdulillah, عندنا فريق كبير, دكتور وحيد طنطاوي, دكتور جمال نيازي, دكتور جمال نيازي بالتحديد, عاملين مع بعض عشرات الحالات, والحمد لله ريزلت كويسه جدا, ولها رولز, هنشوف كم بعض الحالات, وهنقول في الاخر السمري بتاعها. With this technique, biopsy of the lesion is taken under CT control. A radio frequency probe is placed in the center of the lesion, and the 1 centimeter area of bone around the probe is heated to 26 to 30 centigrade for 10 to 20 minutes. The result with this technique has been encouraging with more than 92% success rate in eradicating the nidus. يعني ايه الكلام ده؟ يعني if the technique performed accurately with accurate localization of the nidus with complete eradication by the radio frequency probe ablation, success rate بتعدى فوق ال 92%. وفي كلام في الريتريشن دلوقتي كمان بيتكلم ان بيوصل 96% ايه if accurately localized and cauterized completely without the need for other measures for surgical excision. The equipment must be, you have a generator like the electrocautery with coherent system and a probe and the trocar and cannula and طبعا plus the most important is the CT for the localization of the region. And after puncturing the skin by small incision and the localization under CT control of the lesion, introducing of the wide bore needle, and this is the electrocautery probe for to be inserted to localize inside the nidus for accurate localization. Now after complete localization, a biopsy here is must be taken for confirming the diagnosis. And the generator is applied with the heat to eradicate the lesion. And here, multiple examples from our department in collaboration with Dr. Gamal Niazi. Here, a case of osteoma in the neck of the femur, localized by the CT. And here, after the MRI and the CT. طبعاً, in such case, in the last 20 years, and with all the surgical technique, you must make a window or a gutter to localize the nidus. And if you do this, you have to use DHS and sometimes bone graft to protect against the bone fracture and the neck fracture of the femur if a large window has been done. After making the radio frequency technique, it is very simple technique or small puncture like arthroscopy and directly attack the lesion without a need for internal fixation or a bone graft. And here, after localization of under the CT with the probe of the generator, and here the tip is introduced from the applicator to reach the nidus. And here's after withdrawal and making the heat to circumferential to eradicate and burn the lesion. And here's a post-operative X-ray with the lesion. And here, after 6 months, complete ossification with disappearance of the lesion, with marked day one improvement of the pain in such patient. And here, another example at the level of the calcar area with accurate localization and electrocauterization. And here, another example in the neck of the femur. It is very adherent to the stabilum and the medial after localization and application of the probe with eradication of the lesion. And here another example, but also with full localization of the lesion and accurate result. And here in the stabilum, also, if you wanted to open surgery for this, you will destroy the stabilum by the large window and for accurate localization, and you may need graft or fixation. After the introduction of the radio frequency and after localization of the lesion in the dome, proximally, and here after attacking by the electrocauterization radio frequency technique. And here another example in the medial wall of the stabilum lesion. Here, as we see on the left side, dense sclerotic area, and here it is in the medial wall and superiorly, and here after good localization, and here after attacking by the radio frequency technique with marked improvement of the lesion. Multiple other example here in the tibia, posterolateral, here in the linea aspera, and also attacked from anterior because the risk of the sciatic nerve injury, and here eccentric in the distal metaphysis of the distal femur. And here also this site is very difficult for accurate operative surgical intervention because it is present anterior in the tibial plafond, just subarticular. If you want to reach it, you will induce fracture and mark a large window to localize in the distal tibial plafond. Here, after localization by radio frequency with complete eradication of the nidus. also in the olecranon. This is the lesion with dense sclerosis, and here's the nidus, and here after during application of the probe and electrocauterization by radio frequency technique. Also, here in the middle the proximal phalanx of the middle finger, also attacked by radio frequency, and here in the lateral cuneiform, another example attacked by the electrocautery by radio frequency technique with complete eradication of the nidus. And here in the calcaneus, in the talus, in the head of the second metacarpal, second metatarsal, all of them can be attacked by very small incision, a few millimeter, with application of the probe with eradication by the technique. Also, another example in the neck of the talus, tiny lesion with dense sclerotic area, attacked by radio frequency probe with eradication of the lesion. In the spine, it was risky in the since 10 years after well hydration and probar technique with isolation of the nerve roots can be attacked via a radio frequency probe. And here's a lesion we demonstrated early with sacroiliitis, the injection twice, and after making the CT with localization of the nidus, as we see here and here in the ala of the sacrum, was attacked by radio frequency probe with complete eradication and the pain relief immediately. Also in the sacrum here and here in the C2, all of this location can be attacked now safely through special roots with well hydration around the nerve root to avoid any thermal injury of the nerve root with complete eradication and excellent result. Also here in the spinal canal, lesion is in S1 and here in L5, also all of this location can be attacked. And there is a failure rate in a very small failure rate, about 4 to 8% in the literature. Due to very thick sclerotic bone, due to remaining part of the nidus not completely eradicated, if not done properly. So this is the indication for surgical excision. If it is attacked by radio frequency and due to difficult location, the severe dense sclerotic bone, we cannot reach the nidus localization. So it needs resection by open surgical technique, and this is the lecture, the coming lecture, inshallah, next week. And this is an example of a huge dense sclerotic lesion was attacked by radio frequency. And here, the nidus is very tiny within a dense sclerotic bone, very large. So it is very difficult to penetrate the whole thickness area, so resulting in remaining part of the nidus and recurrence of the symptoms. This is the main cause for failure. So the to summarize, assault osteoma have different presentation, different location, different symptoms according to the reactive bone. So the attack must be attacking the nidus, not the reactive bone. And the radio frequency, as we mentioned, is a mini invasive technique resulting in excellent result if applied by well-trained, specialized radiologist trained over the technique, and its hazard and the complication with success rate, as we mentioned, more than 92%. A very small lesion part of the patient, it needs surgical intervention, a failure of radio frequency, or your area is not equipped by an intervention radiography center or a well-trained personnel. And this is needs surgical intervention. Last in the coming week, we will present two presentation, one for minimal surgical resection with different techniques, especially in the tibia, humerus, and the femur, which needs the surgical intervention. And then Third week, I will present difficult cases with multiple failure or recurrence with surgical intervention and bone graft and internal fixation by different tissue. Thank you for your attention, and we will meet next week, inshallah. شكرا جزيلا.